Shalom. This week's Torah reading in the land of Israel is Parashat Korach, while in the diaspora, the Torah reading is the portion of Shelach, the fourth Torah portion in the book of Bamidbar, Numbers, beginning in chapter 13. This portion focuses on a difficult, perplexing, and painful account. Poised to enter the land promised by God in a matter of days, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses our master, sends out 12 men to do reconnaissance in the land of Canaan just before the entry of the children of Israel. It should be noted that this idea to spy out the land was not commanded by God, rather it was the will of the people, and God reluctantly acquiesced. Although these men were leaders of the tribes of Israel, and each one was considered to be upright and distinguished and righteous, the mission went badly and resulted in disastrous consequences, we could say forever, still reverberating till our very day. For this excursion resulted in a most grievous sin committed by 10 of these men, a sin of such monumental proportions that it has forever changed the shape of history. We read, Moshe sent them to spy out the land of Canaan, and he said to them, ascend here in the south and climb the mountain. See the land. How is it? And the people that dwells in it, is it strong or weak? Is it few or numerous? And how is the land in which it dwells? Is it good or bad? And how are the cities in which it dwells? Are they open or are they fortified? And how is the land? Is it fertile or is it lean? Are there trees or not? You shall strengthen yourselves and take from the fruit of the land. The days were the season of the first ripe grapes. So they returned from spying out the land at the end of 40 days. They went and came to Moshe and Aaron and the entire assembly of the children of Israel to the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh and brought back to them a report, and they showed them the fruit of the land. And they said, we came to the land to which you sent us, and it is flowing with milk and honey, and this is the fruit. However, the people who inhabit the land are mighty, and the cities are extremely huge and fortified. And there we saw even the offspring of the giant. The Amalekites dwell in the southland, while the Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountainous regions. The Canaanites dwell on the coast and alongside the Jordan. Kalev silenced the people to hear about Moshe, and he said, we can surely go up and take possession of it, for we can indeed overcome it. But the men who went up with him said, we are unable to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. They spread an evil report about the land which they had scouted, telling the children of Israel, the land which we pass through to explore is a land that consumes its inhabitants, and all the people we saw in it are men of stature. There we saw the giants, the son of the Anak, offspring of the giants. In our eyes, we seemed like grasshoppers, and so were we in their eyes. Chapter 14 continues to tell us, the entire assembly raised up and issued its voice. The people wept that night. On account of the spies' evil and slanderous and unfounded negative report, which the nation accepted from them as the truth, God decreed that this entire generation would not enter into the land, but only their children, the very children whom they feared would be slain, they would enter. As our sages teach, Hashem declared that because the nation cried that night for no reason, this would be established as a night of crying, and indeed, this was the first Tisha B'Av, the ninth of Av, which was to later become in history the day of the destruction of both the first and second temple and many other calamities that befell the Jewish people. All because the people of Israel, goaded on by these men, showed contempt for the precious land, as King David puts it in Psalms 106, verse 24. Now, it's very difficult to understand what brought about this paradigm shift of consciousness, this crisis suffered by these men who started out as righteous leaders. Was it an emotional or nervous breakdown? There are so many different teachings and lessons regarding the sin of the spies. We do know that this sin, speaking evil against the land of Israel, was more severe in God's eyes than even the idolatry of the golden calf for which he forgave his people. Because the land of Israel represents the very honor of God himself in this world, Hashem decreed that this was the final and fatal straw for this enigmatic, righteous, and yet flawed generation. And it was such a serious transgression that it constantly revisits the people of Israel and needs rectification in every generation. These men returned to the camp and delivered a report that was not only evil, but fictitious. See, there's a difference between lashon hara, evil speech, and diba, slander. Evil speech is anything that can be damaging to a person, even if it's true. It's still forbidden to cause damage or pain to another person, even if you speak the truth. But diba, slander, is a lie, a fabrication. And the spies slandered the land with their report. They literally infected the entire nation with this bluff, this nonsense that it's a land that devours its inhabitants. And this report served to infuse the people with a deep despair and a feeling of hopelessness. They convinced the nation that they would not be able to enter the land, as if to erase from their memory every promise that God made his people since the time of Abraham, that he would bring them to this land and that it would be theirs forever. That night, the first Tisha B'Av of retribution, they set into motion a template of disaster, a process that would now begin with 40 years of wandering through the desert and the death of that entire generation, and ultimately, this process would lead to the destruction of both the first and second holy temples and all the other tragedies that befell us on this very day. So, if we can attempt to understand the root cause, perhaps we can hope towards fixing this sin against the land, so severe that its concentric circles still ripple through our lives. The Torah's message is eternal, and we read this portion each year because the damage is still being done, and it will continue until it's fixed. And we revisit this portion every year because we can fix it. So open up your heart in the deepest way, and remember that in the book of Bereshit, Genesis, we learned in verse 5 of chapter 2 the following. Now all the trees of the field were not yet on the earth, and all the herb of the field had not yet sprouted, for Hashem God had not sent rain upon the earth, and there was no man to work the soil. What's the connection between rain and Hashem not having yet sent rain and a man to work the soil for these all to be mentioned together in this verse? Rashi teaches us that while everything else in creation had already been completed by the sixth day before the creation of man, nothing had blossomed forth yet, nothing had sprouted. All the trees and plants and herbs stood waiting at the edge of the soil, just below the surface, until that Friday, the day of man's creation, because it had not yet rained. And why had it not yet rained? Because there was no man to work the soil, meaning there was no one to appreciate rain's benefit to the earth. But when man came and understood the world's needs, he prayed for the rains, and the rains came, and all the trees and plants burst into blossom. That's what's meant by there was no man to work the soil, that there was no man to pray. Man's job, his divine service, if you would, is to make sure that the world's needs are met. God created an incomplete world, an imperfect world. Everything needs to be completed, and the ultimate tikkun of every aspect of creation is facilitated by man, and thus man is a full partner in creation. This is the meaning of the words of the verse in chapter 2 and verse 3 of Genesis. God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because on it he abstained from all his work which God created to make. This is an unusual expression, which he created to make. He created to make? What does that mean? Hashem created everything in this world in order for a person to make them, to finish them. Man has to plow and plant, to fashion vessels and tools and clothing. He has to knead and bake and cook. Why isn't everything prepackaged and ready-made? Why did Adam have to pray for rain? Hashem designed the world for man to acknowledge that everything was created for his sake, so that he, man, will sanctify Hashem's name through the things of this world, through every aspect of creation. That's the real fixing and completing of creation. And that's the real purpose of creation. Everything in this world is just a little bit underdone so that man will come and finish it. For himself, God didn't need to create this world. It was only for the benefit of man so that we would know who God is. And that's the entire purpose of life. Therefore, open up your hearts in the deepest way. Without man in this world, without someone recognizing the God in it all, Earth has no real purpose and remains incomplete. Man brings the world to completion by acknowledging and thanking Hashem. So Hashem made this world incomplete so that we can fix it. And when we're able to infuse the physical world with the godly, that is, when we can connect between the lower and upper world, between the physical and the spiritual, we create a perfect harmony. That was the goal of the Garden of Eden. And the place where this connection can really happen is the land of Israel. And this is the secret of the heart of the land of Israel, the Holy Temple. Torah calls the place of the Holy Temple the gate of heaven because it's the place of connection. The physical and the spiritual are united there. And Hashem created everything in this physical world so that when a person uses it for good, he connects the inner essence of the physical with its spiritual roots. And this act of elevation of the physical to its source is the true service of God and the job of a person, who is, after all, a combination of body and soul. So bearing all that in mind, upon returning to the camp and relating their experiences to the people, open up your heart now. In the midst of the hysterical rant that comprised the slanderous report, one verse stands out starkly, darkly menacing in its magnitude. In chapter 13 and verse 33, we read, "There we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, descended from the giants. In our eyes, we seemed like grasshoppers, and so we were in their eyes." This confrontation with the giants seems to have been a turning point for the spies. Who are these giants, these titans? In Hebrew, these giants are known as the Nephilim, descended from the original Nephilim. Who are these Nephilim? Actually, we know them. We've met them before. But we haven't seen them around nor heard from them since the book of Genesis. These are none other than the fallen angels of Genesis chapter 6 and verse 4. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days. We've learned about them before. Our sages teach that when God created the world, there was an opinion expressed by certain angels that it's not a good idea to create man, that will only be a disappointment, that he would never live up to his potential, that he'll never be able to get it right. Their opinion is reflected in the verse of Psalms that quotes them, Psalms 8 and verse 5. "What is man that you should remember him, and the son of man that you should be mindful of him?" It's a complicated story with many levels of meaning, but to make a long story short, God kicked these angels out. That's why they're called the Nephilim, the fallen angels. God didn't listen to their opinion, continues the teaching, because God believed in man. Nonetheless, because this opposition opinion was voiced, that negativity made an impression on the universe. It created a certain backdrop of a nagging, negative voice of self-doubt that niggles at the edge of our consciousness that says, "You're no good. You're not good enough. You can't do anything right. God doesn't need you in this world." And this voice challenges man's existence. Really, it's the voice of self-destruction that leads to failure, that trips up a person. The power of negativity, a voice that says, "I don't fulfill any purpose in this world, and I am nothing. My actions don't matter. I'm so insignificant that it doesn't matter what I do." And the deepest secret is that all of our mistakes, which are just temporary disconnects from our higher consciousness, our God consciousness, all of these mistakes, they come from not holding ourselves in enough esteem. Because we don't realize how holy we can be and how much our positive actions make a difference to the world. And all our mistakes come from not realizing the great value of our lives and what we are supposed to be doing in this world. And when we listen for Hashem's voice in our lives, when we search for him and we make the right choices, then we are proving and validating that Hashem made a good decision in creating man after all. We're validating creation. But the nagging, irksome, troublesome voice of these dissenting angels is problematic. And it represents the root of all the mistakes we make, that we don't believe enough in ourselves. We don't believe enough in our right to be here. We're not so sure that we belong in this world. So, open up your hearts in the deepest, deepest, deepest way. Ask yourself, what on earth are they doing here, these Nephilim, of all times and places, all of a sudden, after they've seemingly been on unpaid leave and we lost contact with them since Genesis, here they are in the land of Canaan, the promised land, soon to be known as Eretz Israel, of all places. They just happen to be hanging out here and our heroes unfortunately bump into them. This is the deepest thing in the world. So they see these giants and they feel like grasshoppers in their presence, so tiny. But the men said, "And so we were in their eyes." And it's one thing how you see them, but how do you know how they see you? Are you inside their head to know how they see you? Why are you speaking for them? These Nephilim were opposed to man's creation and they created an accusation at the time of creation. "Why create man?" they said. This is what the Midrashic teaching recounts. "He's only going to sin and disappoint. Why be mindful of him? He's a loser. He'll not be able to do it." Meaning, he's not going to be able to find and reveal godliness through this physical world. Our sages are teaching us something so deep. These angels are the angels of despair. Negativity and a lack of self-esteem are the roots of despair. There's an angel of joy, there's an angel of hope, there's an angel of healing, and these are the angels of despair. God did not agree with them, and he threw them out. He felled them to earth because he does believe in human potential. And no, they are not on par with the Almighty. There's no competition, and they have no power of their own. They're just doing their job, and all this is a metaphor. And through their accusation that they leveled at man at the time of creation, they injected a poison, confusing us and filling us with self-doubt. So it's becoming obvious why the men said we felt like grasshoppers, and so we were in their eyes. Because this is how they felt about themselves, because they were so filled with and taken over by the accusation of these angels, what is man that you are mindful of him? Their own negative self-image took over completely. Their fear. Instead of remembering Hashem's love for them, all they could do was imagine themselves as the worst fear of their own minds. They felt themselves to be tiny, tiny. They were very holy people, but their negative perspective, their negative way of seeing things caused a flaw, and cause them to transfer their own weakness and doubts and project their own shortcomings onto the land of Israel. And through their speech, they impaired it. And they should have connected to the land through faith, since the land itself is an aspect of pure faith in Hashem. It's a reflection of Hashem's faith in us. But instead, they connected to their own fear. They caused a rejection of the land, which was really a rejection of belief in Hashem's promises, and it caused crying throughout the generations. And like everything else in our lives, it was all a matter of choice. And don't you see? Why did these nefarious Nephilim just happen to be in the land only to be seen by our spies? The appearance of the Nephilim here is a signal. Why were the men now confronted by the angels of despair, only to be so strongly affected by the accusation that man will be ineffectual to bring out the best in creation, only to be so strongly affected that they got the bug, they got infected with a negative perspective and saw themselves as grasshoppers? Why? Because since, as we learned, the challenge, the job of a man is to be involved with the physical world and to complete it, to elevate everything to its spiritual root, this is what the nation of Israel's entry into the land of Israel is all about. In essence, the fulfillment of the potential of the land of Israel is a rectification of the Garden of Eden. But in order to approach this work, first, we have to believe in ourselves, or more accurately, we have to believe in Hashem's belief in us, and that choice is always ours, because everything is free choice. And the spies chose, unfortunately, to see the negative. They chose to listen to that nagging voice, because it's so much easier to retreat, to recede and withdraw, to shrink from our job, and rather than believe in ourselves, it's so much easier to say, we're better off in the desert. Their encounter with the Nephilim and the way they reacted teaches us that they weren't able to believe in their own holiness, and thus they were not able to believe that through the holiness of the land of Israel, godliness could be revealed to the whole world. The Nephilim made them feel tiny, tiny. So why not just stay in the desert where we're so close to Hashem, rather than go into the land and have to work hard to infuse every aspect of physical existence with His presence, which is our job? When we choose to see the bad, the negativity sticks to us by choice, by our own choice. Torah is teaching us an important lesson. We can determine the reality of our own surroundings. We can choose our reality. Our perception of the reality of our surroundings is the reality that we ourselves create based on our own inner world. The recurrent theme of our lives, the things that we struggle with, however valiantly, sometimes winning and sometimes losing, the things that we anticipate being good at, and the things that we're convinced in advance that will be failures, all of these things, these cycles, repeat themselves and become the default template of our existence, a manifestation of the limitations that we place upon ourselves as a result of our own disbelief. The episode of the spies didn't have to end in tragedy. It was a choice, and it was based on their negative perspective, personified by their encounter with the Nephilim and their self-imposed grasshopper status. The moment we see ourselves from the limited perspective that we create for ourselves, that is what we broadcast to our environment, and that is the frequency that the world around us picks up. We establish the pattern of our lives, which determines the shape of our particular reality, which becomes the narrative of our life. And when we think positively, when our worldview is based on the joy of living in Hashem's world and the joy of emunah, of faith, and we strive to see the good in everything, we open up the channel to receive heavenly aid. And conversely, the best way to guarantee failure is to believe that we're bound to fail. And with that, we seal our fate, and the universe will respond accordingly. Faith in Hashem means perceiving reality in a more positive light, and then everything really does change for the better. It's not an illusion. Being seen as a grasshopper in the eyes of others, that's an illusion. Through faith in Hashem, the impossible becomes possible. And by connecting to Hashem's faith in us, we can live up to the tremendous potential with which we were all created. Shalom. Please remember to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. If you enjoy these presentations and benefit from these teachings, please consider helping Jerusalem Lights with your support. Only your support enables these broadcasts to continue and grow.